back to the Total Percussion blog. My name is Josh Williamson, and in today's lesson, lesson number 4, we're going to talk about some crash cymbal technique, and I'm going to talk specifically about Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker ballet, and the specific movement we will work with is the coda, the second-to-last movement in the second act. And I'm going to go through some stuff that helps my own crash, and I've taken from a lot of different people, and I don't claim to have invented any of this stuff. I just want to explain sort of how I crash, and maybe sort of explain how I get my sound. And I want to discuss a couple of things in the Nutcracker. And so without further ado, let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to talk about some crash cymbal technique. First thing I'm going to talk about is how I hold the cymbal, which might seem super, super elementary, but I've seen so many different people do it so many different ways. And how I do it is I try to relate everything to a snare drum grip. And the reason being is because I start so many kids on snare drum. And it's just the easiest thing to start off with. If I make their hands matched, hence the name matched grip, I can transfer that to really any percussion instrument that uses a stick. And I like that sort of consistency, especially with younger kids. And so I will continue that unless I hear differently, unless I hear something else. And that's what works for me. So relating everything to snare drum grip, I'm going to relate this strap to my drumstick. And so I'm going to grab it as if I were going to play snare drum with it. And my fingers are going to wrap around the strap. My fulcrum is created with my thumb and my index finger right around the base of the strap, right on the bell. So if you can see that a little better there. And I'm going to attempt to let that rest on my index finger, and my middle finger is going to be involved as well. And I want to be in control of that cymbal. I don't want it flopping around all over the place. I want to be in control. And so that's one of the first things that I see happen with a lot of people, is just that they're not in control of the cymbal. And I think that that's a good thing to be, is in control of the cymbal. And so I make both hands look the same. And then as far as my crash philosophy, I relate my crashes to dynamic levels. And that explains how I'm going to play the crash. So if I have a super small crash, sort of a very soft, very precise crash, I'm going to play perpendicular to the ground. And I'm going to have the cymbals slightly separated, as always. That's nothing new. I'm sure a lot of people have heard about that. But I'm going to play vertically, if you will. So I will play vertical to the ground, exactly perpendicular to the base of the floor. And as I crash louder, I'm going to rotate down to where my dominant hand is on top, so my right hand. And then I'm going to continue to crash and let gravity do the work for me. And I really think this technique works really well. Instead of fighting gravity and playing a soft crash, if I can take gravity out of the situation, at least to where it's working on both cymbals at the same amount of force, because they're facing the ground at the same direction and the same angle, I can play softer, easier, in my mind. And so each crash, I'm also going to want to flam. I am a big proponent of having a flam crash. I believe that opens up the sound. There's less likelihood of a vacuum or a suction crash, something that's going to give no sound at all. And it's also going to give you more overtones. It's going to give a bigger crash. And that's the crash that works for me. So I'm going to demonstrate a couple of things. I'm just going to play some soft crashes down to loud crashes, and then back up again. And then we're going to go over the Tchaikovsky. Okay, so I'm going to go over just our soft crashes down to our loud crashes, and I'll see if I can demonstrate what I'm talking about with my movement of the cymbal. So I'll start soft, I'll work down loud, and then I'll come back. Now, the whole time, we're wanting to keep the cymbals separated. We're going to want to flam and play down and then back up. Thank you. Okay. And that's my basic definition of a crash. And that'll pretty much get me through any situation that I'm involved in using crash cymbals. So let's go now to the coda of the Tchaikovsky. And let's demonstrate. I'll see if I can't demonstrate some crashes there. So there's a couple things that I want to talk about in the coda. I try to do my best of playing the soft crashes up, and then as I move down, that means I was playing louder crashes. That's pretty much the basic technique that I use. Try and keep that flam from bottom to top the entire time. That's something that I can find is really consistent for me. The beginning, that short crash, I wanted to just make sure that it was nice and to the point. It wasn't overbearing. On the other hand, when I was in the pit, usually I was asked for more, and so I just had to do what was told, and even though it wasn't written on the page. And so, as I played through the offbeat crashes, I was just trying to stay consistently offbeat with the basses who were playing downbeats the entire time. Just boom, chick, boom, chick, boom, chick, boom, chick, just keeping that nice and solid, sort of emphasizing what the winds and strings were doing. As they would grow, I would grow as well. Just sort of being musical, if you will. And the one thing that I did want to talk about are after the offbeats, the crashes that I played short usually are played long, just to let them ring. And then I played that in rehearsal, and then that wasn't what the maestro wanted, and so I had to change. Every recording that I had studied, even my music, was marked long. And so then I had to change. And so I'm interested to hear if any of you have experienced something similar to where you've studied, you come in, you play the part correctly, at least the way you think it's going to be played. And even if you're reading the music correctly, and then the conductor or the music director says, no, that's not what I want. And so then you have to adjust accordingly. And I'm anxious to hear if anybody has had any interesting stories, crazy stories, maybe conductors asking you to do outlandish things. I really truly believe, even though that you are the performer and you might have your own opinions about how things are supposed to be played, the conductor is always right. And you sort of have to do what is expected of you, especially if you're getting paid, because you don't want to be that person that's sort of a jerk in the music scene. You need to do what you're told to an extent. And so, yeah, I'm anxious to hear if anybody has had any experiences with that. And so with that, I'm going to stop, and we can do some more discussion on another day about this topic if you so desire. So leave me some comments. I'd love to hear some feedback on totalpercussionblog.blogspot.com. And I would, if you have any questions, to email me at totalpercussionblog@gmail.com. And so thanks for tuning in, and I'll talk to you later.